Christ the newborn King. God is with us, even now His love is here. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. God is with us, even now His love is here. His love is here. Worthy of all our
spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night, and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire of nations, bind in one the hearts of all mankind. Bid thou our sad division cease, and be thyself a king of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, rejoice.
Well, hey, good morning, everybody. Would you stand with us? Thanks for joining us here this morning, and thanks for joining us at home. Let's lift our voices to the Lord. I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for
when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will, for all my days. Oh yes, I will, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. When nothing can stand against, I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. When nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. When nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will, for all my days. Oh yes, I will, for all my days. Oh yes, I will.
There's a place for me. I'm a child.
not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am chosen.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. For I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am.
Everybody, welcome. Whether you're in the room, you can have a seat. If you're at home, I want to extend a warm welcome to you in the Christmas season. After that music, I'm ready to preach, but I won't do that right now, right? But my name's Mike. My pleasure to meet you today. If this is your first time, if you're a guest, if you're tuning in at home for the first time, you're in the room for the first time, welcome. We are a neighborhood church where we want to be a place where anyone can take a next step towards Jesus, a spiritual home for you to belong to be accepted, place to develop, to figure out who you are in Christ so that you can get plugged in here, get plugged in the world, to change the world, to build God's kingdom for him. We love to get to know you. We love to hear how you're doing. We love to pray for you. And really the way to do that, if you're in the room, we have these cards right in front of you. If you fill that out, if you drop that off at the east entrance, we would love that. Or if you're at home, you can either click on the link or you could text TFBC at 94090. We'd love to hear how you're doing, pray for you, and just walk alongside you and just all the kind of stuff that's happening right now all around us in life in 2020. It's almost over, right? So here's what to expect for the rest of today. We're going to sing some more songs when I'm done. We'd love for you to join in and sing along with us if you'd like. The words will be on the screen. We're in week two of our Christmas series, God With Us, really just recognizing, celebrating, and identifying all the blessings that we get because of the fact that Christ came near to us and Christ is available to us right now. Christmas is coming. You're going to hear more about how to connect with us during this Christmas season, how to celebrate Christmas Eve here at TFBC on the screen or on the video just coming up. We'd love for you to check out all the resources. We actually have a Christmas line now on our website if you want to know more information. There's stuff on there to share on your social media pages to invite people to watch either at home or to come in the room. So, let me just kind of pause our hearts, pause the service right now. Let's dedicate this time that we have together to Jesus and confess our need for him. So Jesus, we love you. And we're grateful that we don't define ourselves, that our culture doesn't define us, that history doesn't define us, but you define us. And Jesus, help us to look up. Help us to not look within or to look around to find our worth, our meaning, our value. Help us to look up to you. We're grateful that you made us in your image. And God, we're grateful that you thought of us. You loved us so much that even when we turned our back on you, even we rebelled against you, you entered into our world. And Jesus, help us to marinate in that miracle of the incarnation of Christmas, that God became human flesh. And Jesus, we're grateful that you just didn't go away to the clouds away, but you're available to us right now. You're in us. You're working through us. And Jesus, today we need you more than ever, God. Help us to be aware of our dependence on you right now, Jesus. Speak to us. Move us. Connect our hearts together as we pursue you. We pursue trying to be like you. We pursue trying to restore our relationship with you. And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. Hey, check out the screen and see what's happening at TFBC.
Good morning, TFBC family. We're grateful that we can worship together this morning with you. this is your first time joining us in person, or if this is your first time watching through our live stream, we would love to connect with you and get to know a little bit more about you. You can text TFBC to 94090 to fill out an online connection card, or you can fill out a connection card in person. These are located in the pews in front of you. You can turn those in to the guest services area at our east entrance. We're continually grateful for all of you who are giving sacrificially to the mission of what we're doing here at TFBC. And there's a couple ways that you can give. You can go to our website at tequestaschurch.net and you can click the Give tab that is located at the top of the homepage there to give online. Or you can give in person at the offering boxes that are located at either of our entrances. Hey, we're so excited to be able to celebrate Christmas with you this year. We're gonna be having two candlelight services on Christmas Eve. These are gonna be happening at 4 and 6 p.m. At our 4 o'clock service, we're gonna have childcare from ages birth to 4 years old. And we welcome all other kids to join us in the service. We have these awesome Christmas packets that our kids ministry team has put together for them. Also, you can go to our website and you can go to the Christmas page and you can find out a bunch of different ways that you can invite people to our Christmas Eve services, either in person or online. And if you're in person with us this morning, we have a bunch of invite cards that are spread throughout our church campus. We have them in our small group rooms. We have them at either entrance of the church, and we have them in the fellowship center. And I would encourage you to pick up a few of these invite cards so that you can give them to people that you know that would be interested in joining us for Christmas Eve. Hey, we're so grateful that you can join with us this morning as we worship our Lord and Savior together. Let's stand up and let's continue to worship together this morning.
Yes, everybody, would you stand with us? Thanks. So trust you'll know this next one, and I hope you'll sing along.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With the angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to newborn King. Hail the heavenborn Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man raise the sons of earth, born to give and set convert. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, rise up. Who can stand against us? You are strong to save in your mighty name. King of heaven, come. Behold him come,
offspring of a virgin's womb. Mild he lays his glorified, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give him second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, rise up. Who can stand against us? You are strong to say, in your mighty name, King of heaven, come. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, come. Heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come.
The following scripture is from the book of Philippians, chapter 3, verses 7 through 9. The Apostle Paul writes, "But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith." Gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold.
My shepherd will defend me.
So like I said earlier, we're in week two of this Christmas series, God With Us. And last week we kicked off this series with this idea that presence, being face-to-face, being together, having proximity, it hits different this year, right? I mean, even think about the Christmas songs that we sing. They just feel kind of weird in this cultural moment we're in right now. Like, I'll be home for Christmas, right? Like, you bet you will, right? Have yourself a merry little Christmas, because that's where you're going to be with your lonesome self, right? Just sounds weird. But God came once. Christ, the King of Heaven, the creator of the universe, the image, as Paul says, of the invisible God, born in an animal feeding trough in some kind of backwoods, third world Palestinian forgotten village. But because he came once, and because of his finished work, we can be sure that he will come again. What makes you afraid? What makes you tremble? What makes you shake? Is it like spiders or snakes? Last night I had to kill a roach in my garage. It was disgusting. Or sometimes change makes us get a pit in our stomach. It makes us afraid. And this year just has been, there's been so much change. There's been so much upheaval, so many unknowns. And really, fear has been weaponized in our culture in a way, because fear is a powerful emotion to get us to do certain things. This year, there's a Bible app called YouVersion. You probably have heard of it. It's been downloaded like 450 million times. And the most popular verse, the most bookmarked verse, the most saved verse this year was Isaiah 41:10. I'll check it out on the screen for you. It says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." That verse was read more than any verse across the world this year. We're afraid. We are dealing with fear in all different kinds of ways. And many times we deal with fear, at least I deal with fear, because I feel out of control. I feel small. I feel insignificant. I feel like I can't do anything to change the situation that I'm in. When I bump up to something that's bigger than me, that's stronger than me, that's has more authority than me, sometimes I feel fear. But today we're going to read through a chapter that will show us that in God's presence rests all the authority that we need, all the power that we need that can help us and help our fears evaporate as we trust in Him. So turn with me to Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8. Matthew is the first book of the second part of the Bible called the New Testament. As you find your way there, as you click your way there, just a little background. Matthew was one of the initial 12 followers, disciples, apostles of Jesus, who was an eyewitness to most of Jesus' ministry. And just the next chapter, actually, Matthew chapter 9, Matthew gives an account of when Jesus came to him as a tax collector and called him out of his business there. And so here's a little background, though, of the chapters that precede chapter 8. So Matthew starts with Jesus' birth. He starts with, and then he jumps into John the Baptist's ministry. We talked a little bit about him last week, his parents, Zechariah and Elizabeth. Then Jesus goes out to the wilderness. He's tempted. He then starts his ministry. He starts to get a huge following because he's doing these supernatural things, these miracles that no one has seen or heard of. And then Matthew chapter 5 through chapter 7, the most famous sermon that's ever been preached. Every pastor's dream at the end of the sermon, people are like astonished at what Jesus was saying. And they noted that he spoke with an authority that they had never seen, that they had never come in contact with, they had never experienced. And now we come to this chapter that we're going to read here. So let me read just verses, chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. It says, "When he came, Jesus came down from the mountain, great crowds followed him. And behold, a leper came to him and knelt before him, saying, 'Lord, if you will, you can make me clean.' And Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him, saying, 'I will, be clean.' And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, 'See what you say, see that you say nothing to anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a proof to them.'" And so we read this amazing story, this supernatural story. Jesus is famous, skyrocketed. He's done these miracles in chapter 4. He does this sermon in chapter 5. People, they want to see him. They want to rub shoulders with him. He comes down from a mountain, and like the Pied Piper, there's just crowds. They want to be close to him. They want to see what happens next. And so this guy with leprosy, which is just a disgusting disease, flesh-eating disease, he's apparently heard about Jesus. He has enough faith in him that if he can just get close to him, if he can just get to Jesus, maybe something miraculous will happen. And you may not know this, or you may know this, back in this time, especially in Israel, people with this condition, it wasn't just a physical ailment. It didn't just affect them physically. It affected their whole life. They were social outcasts. They were pushed outside their family. They were separated from their family. They were separated from normal life. They had to kind of live on the outskirts of society with other people that had this disease and kind of scavenge for food. They were also separated from the family of God. They were not allowed to go into the temple. They were not allowed to participate in the normal kind of aspects of what the Jews did to worship. So this guy, he has this disease. He's been pushed out of his family. He's been pushed out of society, and he's been separated from the people of God. And notice what he said. He said, "Lord, if you will, I know you can make me clean. I know you can make me whole." And what a statement of faith, right? This guy, he could have just given up, right? He could have given in to his fears of being pushed away or rejected. He could have given in to just the fact that, hey, the rest of my life, I'm going to have to be distanced from my family, distanced from the people that I love, distanced from what I love to do, distanced from God, really. But he puts his faith out there, and notice what Jesus does first. He doesn't speak first. He reaches out, and he touches him, which most spiritual leaders would not do, because that would mean that you're ceremonially unclean. You couldn't go to the temple yourself. But Jesus wasn't afraid of what people would think. He wasn't afraid of the implications, because Jesus held all the authority. And so Jesus reaches out and he says, "I will be clean." Before their very eyes, this guy's skin disease evaporates. And he's whole. But he's more than just whole physically, right? Because now he can go back to his life, back to his family. Now he can go back and worship his God in the way that God had called him to do as a Jew. And so my first truth for us today is, as we try to drive out our fear, as we try to get rid of the fear that we have in our life, we need to remember that Jesus' authority brings wholeness. Jesus' authority is designed to bring wholeness to your life. And as we submit to his authority, as we believe in his authority, not only will our fears dissipate, but we can gain complete wholeness. We can gain spiritual wholeness. Because what Jesus did here was way more than a physical healing. Now, Jesus can heal physically if he wants to. He does do it. But more than this, this is a supernatural miracle where this guy was connected back to his creator and to his spiritual family. And so today, maybe that's you. Maybe you're in that place where you feel spiritually isolated, you feel pushed out, you feel pushed out. Maybe you actually do have a health crisis. Jesus' authority is there for us to submit to obey, to lean into. And when we do, we don't just get some physical miracle. We don't just get the answer to our problem. We get something way bigger than we could ever imagine, a wholeness as we get connected back to our Creator, back to our spiritual family, back to the way that God intended our life to be. So we're not going to read the next few verses, but Jesus goes on. He performs two more miracles. He hears a centurion's servant. He heals Peter, the apostle's mother-in-law. And just setting the stage for people to see that I'm not just a dude. I'm not just a man. I have all authority. I will do as I please. I am God walking the earth. So I want to jump down to verses 18 through 23 of chapter 8. Verses 18 through 23. It says, "Now when Jesus saw a crowd around him," remember, he's doing all these miracles. The crowds are swelling. "He gave orders to go to the other side. And a scribe came up to him and said, 'Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go.' And Jesus said to him, 'Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head.' Another one of the disciples said to him, 'Lord, let me first go and bury my father.' And Jesus said to him, 'Follow me and leave the dead to bury their own dead.'" Now, these are very famous verses, and they can be difficult to understand because, let's be honest, they sound really strong, right? Let the dead bury the dead? Like, wow, Jesus. What does that actually mean? And we'll get to that, what that really means in a second. But here's the point, I think, of what Matthew's trying to make here in this kind of controversial wowza moment that he gives here. How often do you have fear of the future? How often do you have fear of your financial future, fear of your career, fear of relationships, fear about missing out, fear of how things are going to work out in the arena of your life, fear of your career, fear of your kids' education, fear over society? And the point that Jesus is making here is this, my second truth for you, that Jesus' authority requires a response. Jesus' authority that's out there for us, it actually requires a decision. It's a line in the sand for us. Are we going to respond and live in the land of his authority, or are we just going to live with our own authority? But when we choose his authority, even though the packaging looks scary, even though we're not sure what's going to happen, even though it looks like there's a lot of risk and clouds and darkness and unsurety, if you want to abate and calm your fears, if you want to release the pressure of the present, the future, and the past, Jesus says, follow me. My authority requires a response. Now, what was Jesus really saying? Was Jesus saying, hey, skip your dad's funeral and like come with me right now? Probably not. Now, most scholars would say that in this culture, if this guy's dad was really in that state, he wouldn't have been hanging out with Jesus. Like, he would have been with his dad. He would have been at his dad's funeral. But what it probably was saying was this. In this culture, family expectations were king. And so what this guy is probably saying is, hey, Jesus, you know, my dad's got this business. Like, I got to go take care of it. I got to make some money. I got to make sure everything's in order. And when the time is right, when the time is convenient, I'll be your man. I'll be there for you, which was the normal cultural thing to do for a son. And so that message is just as strong for us today, us who have the weight of cultural expectations on us, the expectations that are put on us for career, for family, for education, for money, to get a little bit ahead so you can give your kids a push so they can get a little bit ahead so that they can get ahead and give their kids a little push so that they can get more ahead. The American dream, right? And so today, as Jesus calls us to submit to his authority, it is an authority that drives out all fear, but also requires the interruption of normal life. The interruption of normal cultural expectations that we all face as we live in this world. So you might be thinking, Mike, this is Christmas. I want like a fluffy sermon. Like I want nice angels and harps and stars and donkeys and babies. But as we come in contact with a God who's in human flesh, a God that is with us, a God that has all authority, as we get near to him, his presence begs a question. His presence forces our hand. Are we going to respond to his authority? Are we going to believe? Are we going to surrender? Are we going to give in to that life of freedom that Jesus promises if we do respond to his authority? All right, let's keep going because this chapter is full of amazing things. So this is verse 23 through 27. It says, when he, Jesus, so, you know, the crowds are there. He's trying to leave, try to go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. These guys stop him. He says those things. Hey, you need to respond to my authority. And then so he gets in the boat. His disciples follow him. And behold, there arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by the waves. But he, Jesus, was asleep. And they went and woke him, saying, save us, Lord, we're perishing. And he said to them, why are you afraid, O you of little faith? Then he rose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. And the men marveled, saying, what sort of man is this that even winds and sea obey him? All right, so remember, Matthew, he's building this theme of authority. Jesus speaks with authority. He has authority to bring wholeness. His authority requires response. And then we just get into this amazing scene where Jesus has authority over everything, right? That's my next theme for us. Jesus holds all authority. There's nothing in the universe that he is not in control, that he does not hold in his hand, that he does not direct. So put yourself in the disciples' shoes, right? They just see all this stuff. People literally have leprosy, right? It's disgusting. Like, you can see that they have it. It's not like a joke. It's not makeup. It's not Hollywood. It's gone. They see this centurion servant heals from afar. They see Peter's mother-in-law healed, all these other miracles that are happening. And then they see Jesus respond to this, these two guys, a scribe and another disciple, and now they're in the boat. Jesus falls asleep. Mark and Luke also have this miracle. Mark's account's a little bit juicier. He gives us some more details. He says Jesus was asleep on a pillow. So Jesus is laying down on a pillow, and they're out in the Sea of Galilee. There's a legit storm. They're scared. Now remember, some of these guys, we may sometimes overplay this. I don't think so, though. Some of these guys were legit fishermen, right? Salty, grinding, catching fish. Their family caught fish. Like, they aren't all like softies with keyboard hands, right? They're guys, they know how to operate a boat. They've been on the sea before. And what's interesting, they legitimately think they're going to die, right? The winds are blowing, waves are coming, like, water's coming in, right? Boat's filling up. Thaddeus is in the fetal position. Peter and John are yelling at him, like, get up, you sissy. Judas is, like, going through all their wallets trying to steal money. And then they finally, they're like, oh, my gosh, like, we're going to die. Like, Jesus is asleep. Like, maybe we should do something about this. So I've always, I'd love to, like, I hope in heaven someday we can, like, re-see all these things. But I've always wondered, like, how they wake him up. Was it, like, your kids, like, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus? But, like, what's only in the Bible is, we're dying. Like, wake up. So Matthew, Luke, Mark, they kind of have a little bit different details because, you know, just if we were in the situation, we would all have kind of a little bit of details. Mark has Peter's account. Luke has accounts from all kinds of people. So Jesus said in these verses, why are you afraid? Or you have little faith. Mark says, why are you afraid? Have you still no faith? And then what would you pay to see this? Jesus is asleep. They yell at him. He gets up. He just walks to the boat. And he says, peace, be still. Maybe yelled, I don't know. And all of a sudden, everything evaporates. Like, it's clear, it's calm. The danger is averted. The storm's there. And now it's not. Jesus holds all authority. This is his world. We're just living in it, right? This is his story. He just invited us to play a small role in it. And not to over-spiritualize this, but obviously we all face storms, right? We all are in the boat when we feel like it's going down. We all are afraid. And in those moments when we feel like it's all going under, this is it, this is the end of whatever, the end of my marriage, the end of my relationships, the end of my career, the end of my faith, maybe. Jesus says the same lines to us. Why are you so afraid? Do you have little faith? Do you have any faith? Did you forget who I am? And what Matthew's trying to show us early is the truth that the disciples were just warming up to. That title, Emmanuel, that Isaiah prophesied way hundreds of years earlier, God with us, God here now, it meant way more than Isaiah could ever understand when he gave it. It meant way more than the shepherds and Mary and Joseph could understand on that night when the angels visited. Like I said, the image of the invisible God in the universe was on a boat in the Sea of Galilee. How I want to wrap this up today is with that question that I just asked, that Jesus asked his followers in this amazing moment. Luke says it this way. I think the way he said it is powerful. This is from Luke's account of this very moment. Jesus said to them, "Where is your faith?" And then Luke says, they were afraid and they marveled, not at the storm, not of dying, but actually of Jesus, saying to one another, "Who then is this, that he commands even winds and water, and they obey him?" You know, disciples were like us. When we're going through stuff, when we look around, whatever we're going through, the storm seems more powerful. It seems more real. We can feel the wind. We can hear the rain hitting us. And you know what? The danger is real. The storm was real. They could have died. There's real danger in the situations that we face in our relationships as we live our life. The fear of the unknown. There's danger. But we forget the most powerful element, person, being that exists in the universe. It's the one who is with us, the one who is in us, the one who is beside us. And Luke says that interesting phrase that they were now afraid of Jesus. Now, not in the way that we think of fear, not in a cowering, not in a non-approachable way, but they were in awe of who Jesus was. And they're beginning to realize who this guy was that they were walking around with. And the fear that they had of Jesus, it wasn't restrictive. It didn't push them down and push them out. It freed them in a way that they could be who God actually designed them to be. So my last point is this, that Jesus' authority should drive us to worship. The authority that Jesus has over us is not to make us feel low. It's to make us treasure who he is and see who we can be in light of him. There's a lot of fear out there right now. Maybe you have fear. Maybe the world feels more uncertain to you than it's ever felt. Maybe as a parent, you're thinking, like, how am I going to raise my kids like in this? Or maybe it's more personal. Maybe you're going through a situation that you don't see a resolution to. You don't see a way out of. You don't see a happy ending. And you're frozen in fear. But today, because Christ came near, because he has all power, because he has all authority, because Christ is with us, the King, the creator of the universe, the holder of stars and galaxies, healers of diseases, the calmer of storms. No matter what you're going through, even if your storm doesn't subside like the disciples did, Jesus' authority is extended to you and over you. Not in a suppressive, oppressive way, but as a shelter, as a rock, as a protector, because he holds authority over everything. And his authority, it brings wholeness. It brings wholeness to our soul. It brings wholeness to our life. It brings wholeness to our relationships. It brings us back into who we were supposed to be, connected to our Heavenly Father. His authority, it requires a response from us. It requires us to do something, and that correct response is worship. To throw our lives on his authority, to see who he is. So today at TFBC, I just want to let you know I love you. I love being your pastor. And I pray that this Christmas season you rest in the authority that Christ has over your life. Will you pray with me? Jesus, we love you. And Jesus, I'm so grateful every time I read the Bible that you made sure that we got your thoughts, that you made sure that we got your plan, that you made sure we got your design. You didn't leave us groping in the dark trying to piece it all together. You gave us your direct line to you and to your plan. And Jesus, thank you for these stories just that show our humanity, that we resonate with, that encapsulate all that we feel as we live our lives. And we're so grateful for this season where we take a month to remember. We walk through a liturgy of remembrance that you came near. And that, yeah, it's not all as it should be yet, but because you came near, we can rest that you're coming again and that you're with us right now. And Jesus, we're grateful that whatever we're up against right now, you're bigger. Whatever we're facing right now, you're stronger. Whatever we're feeling, you have the balm. Jesus, help us to come to you and lean into your authority. Jesus, help us to look past the waves and the wind and the leprosy and the stress of our expectations. And help us to cling to you. And we're grateful, Jesus, that your path is the path of wholeness. Your path is the path of peace. Your path is the path of freedom. You carry our burden for us. Your burden is easy and your load is light. And Jesus, I pray right now, if there's people in this room that need help, God, they need to bring it to you. They need to submit to your authority. God, I pray that they would reach out to us. Pray that they would text us, call us, email us, fill out cards, whatever it may be, Jesus. Help us to help each other lean into your authority. And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. Hey, I hope you have a great week. Look forward to being with you together next week. Have a great day.
Too certain, poor shepherd.